Hi, this is Danny.
And this is Alissa from The Agonist.
And you're watching
Bare Bones Music Network.
Bare Bones Feature Artists.
The way we came up with the, you know, signature Agonist sound, I guess, is just exactly the same kind of thing. We just jam out riffs and we throw on the lyrics and the melodies after. I think that we're just discovering it as we go, you know, like we discovered our sound for this album, but on the next album, who knows what the sound will end up being.
Myself and other people in the band, we all like talked about it too. We're all kind of on the page of like, we like bands where it's like sort of each album has its own theme and like its own color and texture. So then this one, it sort of dived more in a dark side, in a more almost medieval type of melodies and whatnot. So, and the artwork sort of matched that on purpose, basically. And like she said, it is sort of just by accidents in a way that the riffs and things come about. But then once everything is there, especially once it gets to the studio point, then it actually becomes more of a conscious effort to establish a certain type of sound for a certain song.
Actually for me on the first album, I had everything, all my vocals like planned, laid out, harmonies all written, every rhythm, every tone, everything was all planned out. But for the second album, I actually let it go a little bit more organic. I just kind of went into the studio with, you know, lyrics in mind, and I wrote most of the melodies and rhythms, but I didn't have all the harmonies written and I didn't have all of the ideas in mind, because a lot of the songs that were on the album we had never played live previous to recording them. And so I didn't have, you know, this live way of singing it already set in my head. So I was able to sort of expand upon, because I mean, there's a lot more room to grow in studio because you can actually hear what you're doing and you're not dealing with a different venue every night. And so, so I was able to sort of expand upon what I already knew I could do in studio and sort of bring my vocals to a different sort of area than the first album.
Yeah, and I guess part of the diversity comes from the fact that all the members in the band are just that diverse. If you were to just take all the iPods that are in the van with us, you would see how diverse it gets, from anything from, it's like punk, metal, classic rock, jazz, opera, blues, pop. We were listening to Michael Jackson on the way here. It's just, we're very open to all styles of music.
Musically it differs mostly in the way that, I mean, when we wrote Once Only Imagine, we were like 17 or 18, like we were pretty young. And we were just coming together as a band. You know, we didn't even have, like, our current drummer, Simon, wasn't even in the band at that point. And our other guitarist, Chris Adolph, he wasn't in the band at that point either. And, you know, it was just songs that we sort of wrote, like a new and up and coming band to play at our shows. You know, we put them all together, recorded a demo, and then Century Media picked up that demo and decided to release it as an album, you know? So it's like, it's definitely a very true representation of, you know, who we were at the time. And now with Lullabies for the Dormant Mind, we were able to, I think, be a little bit more mature about our songwriting and, you know, really take into consideration what we like in songs and what we don't like in songs. And I mean, there's always a back and forth between the members of the bands because we all have different tastes, but we were able to sort of bring it all together into, you know, this package that honestly, I mean, up until the last day of recording vocals, I still didn't know what it was going to be. You know, even only once it like got there and it was in my hand, I was like, okay, so this is what it sounds like. Because I mean, it was just so different. It was like very, you know, over the top studio time. So like, it was really, it was kind of like an adventure to record it because I wasn't sure of what was going to come out of it the whole time. So
yeah, and basically, as well, adding, let's say, Simon to the group did change a lot from a drum standpoint. It was a big change because he is much more experienced and influenced by all forms of metal, whereas previous drummers we worked with were more into other styles and not as much of an aggressive type drumming style. So he brings in that real metal style drumming, which automatically just makes the rhythm section that much heavier.
Yeah.
The riffs did also get heavier and faster and more technical, but with the drumming on top, especially if you take a song like Tempest, if you were to take the drum tracks out, it's a very different song.
Yeah.
I think since we've started, like even at just our very first shows in like tiny bars or even our first show ever was actually in someone's house when we were teenagers.
Yeah. Yeah.
But everyone in the band was always about that. If you're going to see a show, we're not just going to see someone like press play on the album and have the guys stand there and just play it.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, I think pretty much we come from the school of, you know, making the live show a whole experience in itself. Like, the album is an experience, like the visuals of the album, like the photo shoots and the videos are an experience, and the live show is a whole other experience. And like, you know, it wouldn't be the first time, like, I mean, we've heard many times that, like, you know, our show, like, our music is much heavier live than it is on the album, which I think comes from the intensity of the show. And I mean, it's just, we want to have fun when we're playing a show, you know, like, this music is what drives us, and we want to, you know, kind of let it out on stage, and that's what gets the fans going too. And when there's that reciprocation between us, that's what really gets us going. To me, it's always been, to me, whether it was a man or a woman on stage, it's always been the same thing. Like, if I like the music, I'll dig it, and if I don't, I won't. Like, I don't care what gender they are, you know. It's hard to say because the music industry is changing in so many ways right now. Like, extreme changes are going on. But I mean, like, when I first started out in bands, like, the only thing I would get, like, I was in like a my first band was like a progressive metal sort of Dream Theater type band, still with the same kind of vocals, like a lot of screaming and some singing, and all I would get was Evanescence, but it sounded nothing like Evanescence, right? And I was so confused. I was like, how are they drawing this parallel? Like, I don't understand. It's not goth rock. It's not on TV. It's not mainstream. It's like really progressive, 13-minute long songs. We're using some great musicians here. Like, you know, I was like not getting it. And then I was like, are people really drawing that just because I'm female? And that was like sort of a slap in the face in the beginning, because I was like, okay, I got to prepare to really be compared to bands that have nothing to do with me just because I'm a girl, you know?
From the other perspective, and if you speak to anyone else in bands, like you mentioned before, Walls of Jericho, in this moment, these bands that have female singers, it's like the band also takes a bad reflection from, let's say, fans that are against it or who can't support a female-fronted band. They'll start to, you know, say things about the band, about, oh, the band has, you know, shouldn't even be there. They're only there because they have a girl in the band. But if you look at a lot of these bands, it's like there's so much talent there behind all of them. And it's just, it's just closed-mindedness. You know, there's going to be closed-minded people for all things, and you just accept it. But I know that there's a lot of open-minded people there too. So it's really, you know, not a problem. You just deal with it and fight through it.
I personally really like singing like The Tempest, Martyr Art, Birds Elope with the Sun. Those are like some good ones to play live because they have a lot of different things going on and a lot of different voices in use. So those are cool for me. I mean, just overall, like some of the songs like Thank You Pain, like there's no room to breathe in that song, and it's very, very challenging vocals. Like, I go from like my lowest point to my highest point in my range. But I mean, it's fun to sing too. It's just that it's a little bit less fun than some of the other songs, just because I have to focus so hard that I can't rock out as much. But yeah, like pretty much all the new songs we play are like amazing to play live.